think Arul is going to touch a very important topic for all of us, the preoperative assessment, which many of us fail to do, actually, taking care of the ocular surface, the taking care of the dry eye, the lid margin disease. I think it's very important before you do cataract surgery, especially for a premium IOL. Arul, over to you.
Good afternoon, thank you. MGD, meibomian gland dysfunction, leading to dry eye, which causes symptoms, but leads to poor quality of vision and gives rise to a lot of headache for us post-refractive surgery, post-cataract surgery, and particularly post-refractive cataract surgery. So you look at it just simply stays at the face that this is the most common disorder that you face in your clinic every day. No, we may not be recognizing it or treating it actively unless the patient complains about it. Depending on what you look at, a huge number of our patients who are coming into our practice every day are suffering from some kind of dry eye or the other. And the most common dry eye is meibomian gland dysfunction. That is very clear. And that is the most common reason for dissatisfaction from a patient after undergoing a cataract surgery. And you say it's 6x6 for distance. And if you put on a multifocal lens, it's N6 for near. And the patient is very unhappy with the quality of vision. It affects every stage of cataract surgery. We start at the surgery planning. You have a patient who's got dry eye and you're planning your surgeries. Your K values can be skewed. The axis can be skewed. And eventually, you can land up with a refractive surprise just because you did not recognize this dry eye in the beginning at your surgical planning stage itself. Postoperatively, they have this discomfort. I was fine before surgery, and after surgery, I'm not happy. I've got irritation, burning, itching, all kinds of things. Because this gets worsened by the trauma of surgery and all the drops that you use post-surgery. So it's not that your surgery caused the dry eye. The dry eye was pre-existing, which we didn't notice. The patient didn't complain, or there was at the edge of the chasm and they fell into it post-surgery. Refractive outcome, exactly what I said. Your surgical planning can go completely haywire and you can get a very, very poor refractive outcome, either in the sphere or cylinder or in the axis or all three put together. The most important, quality of vision. The patient reads 6x6 and he says, everything is waxy. I can't see anything clearly. So all these things start off. So when you want to handle a patient, you look at these dry eyes right from the beginning, look at the keratometry itself is something that can get affected. And if you look at statistics, it says that if you treat dry eye and then do a keratometry, you have 32% of patients have change in their axis before and after, the K values. And 40, we have to change the treatment plan itself. And residual refractive astigmatism can be as high as 50% if you don't handle this preoperatively. So how do you look at MGDs? Looking at it is doing the meibography. That's just one. Structure and function need not be absolutely aligned. You could have somebody with a poor structure with excellent function and vice versa, but that's one thing to look at. Of course, nothing beats simply doing a TBOT, or nothing beats just sitting the patient on a keratometer, switching it on, and seeing the Myers, and seeing how long the Myers stay undistorted before the patient blinks. That itself will give you a very, very important clue as to what you're facing. So meibography is something we all rely on. That is in one way for you to have one more evidence and also to show to the patient. You can't show the patient the Myers. You can show the patient, this is what is wrong with your meibomian glands. I treat it and you might get better. We see all kinds of meibomian gland dysfunction that is shocking. And don't think that you see these only in the older age groups of 40, 50, or 60. We do see meibomian gland dropout and all weird shapes and sizes in teens these days because of lack of blinking reflex or partial blinks, and the two lids do not meet together with force, prolonged stasis the meibomian glands, and they go in for meibomian gland dysfunction. You're seeing it in much younger age group too. So we'll skip there. Now what happens? If you were to look at ray tracing, a person who has got a poor corneal surface, and this is what it looks like, and that translates into this is what the patient sees, the quality of vision. You treat the person for meibomian gland dysfunction, whichever way, whether you do lipid flow, you do something else, or you just put lubricating drops, or you put in anti-inflammatory drops, you put in low-dose steroids, you improve the surface, and this is how it improves. And that's extremely important for you to recognize that this is possible and this is needed. Imagine this, if you were to take a K reading for this kind of a cornea and you think everything was fine and everything goes haywire, you also get not only a patient is unsatisfied because of the quality of vision due to dry eye, unsatisfied because the refractive outcome also has been compromised right from step one. You can see any number of these things, very mild, eventual poor quality, treat, and the quality improves. So this is truly possible. And also, if you look at higher order aberrations, you see a patient with a dry eye, the corneal tear film is the one that's most important, it is poor quality, and you have a whole lot of higher order aberrations, you treat the dry eye, higher order aberrations come down. Imagine this patient having these kind of higher order aberrations in the cornea, post multifocal lens, he or she is going to be very unhappy with the quality of vision. So treating it preoperatively is great. If you don't catch it then, at least catch it afterwards and treat it and get the best results. So vector thermal pulsation therapy works extremely well. There's no two things about it, because when you have stasis in the glands, the stasis has to be evacuated. That means you need to use pressure. Heat helps to liquefy the stasis material, and the pressure lets you to express it out. Once that is done, other additional treatment that you would do, hot fomentation and massage or drops, will help the patient to come back with proper meibomian gland function over a period of time and bring down all the symptoms of dry eye. So we all know that, of course, this vector pulsation therapy has been there for quite some time. We've been all using it with excellent results. It uses a pressure of around 2 to 5 psi, and the heat is generated up to 40 to 45 degrees on the internal surface of the lid. That's where you need the heat to go, not on the skin. Any amount of heat on the skin is not going to transmit into enough heat going into the meibomian gland to liquefy the material and take it out. So it's quite important that the heat is done from inside and expression also is done. Just to show you, I would urge all of us to pick up, it's now all the instrument makers have started to come up with meibomian gland expressing forceps. Believe me, it's going to open your eyes. This is exactly one patient who was treated and not happy, and this is what you see. He's a young person, he's only in his 50s, and just see what you see coming out on just pressing. This is after the person has been treated for dry eye, massage, hot fomentation. And how do you expect this to get better unless you heat it from inside and express it out? And I'm very surprised. This I started doing under the microscope in the OT. Now I start doing a microscope in the OP and on slit lamp. And you surprisingly pick up a whole bunch of these blocked glands in patients who appear to have no symptoms. Remember, these blocked glands are also infected, and they're secreting material. They're not completely blocked. And this material that comes from the conjunctival sac is inflammatory in nature. So the whole ocular surface is angry, unhappy, and becomes more unhappy post your surgery, and then the patient becomes more unhappy. So it's extremely important that you look at these. Even if you don't do mapography, even if you don't do TBUT, just grab this forceps and press on the lid. I just found out, I went to one of the stalls, and Kamal Kapoor grabbed 10 of those. There's only one left. So I think they should not look at it. It's something that's very important. You can take even an epilation forceps and press. You don't have to buy this. They charge you an arm and a leg. They want 10,000 rupees for this forceps. And Katina wants 46,000. So yes, take an epilation forceps and press and see. You will be really surprised as to the amount of sins that we don't discover. And we just happily go ahead doing a lot of things and then scratch our heads and feel unhappy, both the patient and the surgeon. It well worth diagnosing dry eye early and treating it early appropriately and getting the best for our patients. So treatment of MGD is paramount to achieving satisfactory results in cataract surgery and, of course, in refractive surgery too. Vector thermal pulsation helps in achieving satisfactory results in all of these conditions. Thank you.
Thank you, Arul. I think it was a really eye-opener for all of us. A simple maneuver like pressing the lid with a blunt forceps is, I think, phenomenal. Very, very important, very crucial, I think, preoperatively, not only for any premium, like any lens, any cataract surgery for that matter. So what is you do this for all the patients, and you do, suppose they find, you find some problem, you treat them, and what is the duration between your surgery and the treatment? And the
that's actually a difficult question to answer. I don't do it on all patients. This is something I started doing in the last about 6 to 8 weeks. Mm. It really opened up my eyes. Now, when you see this kind of a blockage, you see you press and you see very clear secretion coming out, you're great, you're fantastic, don't do anything more. Maybe just hot formulation enough. You see opalescent material coming out, yes, you could do the vector thermal pulsation, lipid flow, and get the best for the patient. You see something like this, you have to treat this patient long term with doxycycline or tetracyclines for long periods of time, 4 weeks, along with omega-3 fatty acids. You need to do a lot of stuff. You can't get this person on the even keel in overnight. Such severe conditions will need treatment for prolonged periods of time, a month, maybe two, where you handhold the patient, keep looking at what's going on, and multiple treatment protocols. So you need not wait all that while to do the surgery, maybe start it. Once you see the TBOT is better and the ocular surface is not so angry, go ahead with your surgery. But telling the patient that he or she has to come back to this protocol and be on it for maybe 3, even 6 months.
That's very fine. And what is coming out? Is it meibomian secretion or it's pus?
See, it depends. Now I had a patient who now sent it off for microbiology, and we just grew some cocci.
Cocci.
And sensitivity is coming out today. And this person has been on the one that has expressed.
Yes.
Was after 1 month of doxy. Now, these are people that are very unhappy. He's been being treated all over the place for 2 years and not feeling any better. And he comes and says, vision is good, 6x6, he's fantastic. I'm very unhappy, doctor. I can't sit in a meeting. I can't look at anybody in the eye. I keep on doing this. I can't sit. I can't do my business.
Yeah,
and this guy, nobody could figure out what is going on.
Absolutely.
And this is what threw up.
I think not only unhappy from the point of view, but also we have to be, it's a little dangerous, because if you have pus in the lid margin, and that can get contaminated. And one of the most common causes of endophthalmitis is lid margin disease. So I think it's very important. It's really a fantastic talk. Arul, Ritu, anything?
Yeah. So any experience with IPL? Because I've been using it for the last year and a half, and that too gives very good results, intense pulse.
Absolutely nil. I think
I have been using IPL, yeah.
Now, what we need to look at is whether you do the lipid flow or IPL, we need now to quantify this, not just go by TBOT. TBOT could just get better if the ocular surface that was rough got a little bit healed by anti-inflammatories or steroids that he used or drops that he used. We need to actually look, are we dealing with totally blocked glands? Do they open up with this condition? Do they open up partially? And how much of the glands opened up? What glands were secreting pus or not secreting pus anymore? So I think we need to completely reorient our thinking once we've seen this. So more and more of us should start doing actual expression and noting it down.
I agree. Just a simple push test on the lower lid works very well.
No, it doesn't. Believe me, a lot of these people...
No, for diagnosing. I don't mean for treatment.
No,
I mean for each patient.
Even diagnosing, it's not easy.
You're pressing the lid against the eye, which is a soft structure, which is also sitting in the bony orbit. Among fat, it moves in. You really can't get... Unless it's a very, very, grossly... block gland that is just waiting to be expressed out. These kind of glands I've tried,
no, not for therapy. I'm just saying
even diagnosis, I think,
there's nothing like holding it with the forceps and pressing.
Absolutely.
Believe me, once you start that, you'll change your mind.
No, I've been doing ocular surface analysis for most patients where you suspect MGD, as you're saying, actually pressing each patient.
What you do, you press one patient, you've decided this is not a bad lid at all. The same patient, just express with and then you'll...
I guess you, basically, Dr. Ritu, you want to say that by just pressing the lid, you can see the pouting of secretions and the secretions that are there at
the margin.
Agreed, you can. It can be misleading sometimes. That's what I want.
One thing, sir, just I wanted to add that, the doxycycline that is used is, the dose is not for anti-infective purpose. It is basically anti-inflammatory.
So
that's why even after use of doxycycline, one can have. Earlier, we never thought that there can be infection associated with it, but there are a couple of reports wherein, as you said, cocci has grown and organism has grown. So that is something which really needs
to be dealt proactively
rather than just by routine things.
at least 4 weeks, 100 milligrams a day.
200 milligram loading dose and then follow by 100 milligrams.
4 weeks?
6 weeks.
Well, I've tried even 8 weeks in patients.
Yeah.
That's fine.
Yeah. Can give that. I've used IPL Ritu, and we have been using IPL for almost 3 years now. It's pretty good. And we do 3 sittings for severe cases like this. What we have shown, 15 days apart, 0, 15, and 30, like that we do. So it's pretty good. Only thing is, what Arul was mentioning is what you are mentioning is a passive pressure on the lid that may not reveal the iceberg. Yeah, it will reveal only the tip of the iceberg.
Sure.
Active pressure, you compress the lid and then from underneath it will come out. So that's what I think is a very good point which has been